Okay, hi everyone. So I think it's the last lecture in this hall. My name is Yulia. I'm moderating this hall for today. Please meet Michael. He'll tell us how to succeed on Kickstarter, even if you are not a game celebrity.
Okay. Thanks for coming. Thanks for the intro. Sorry, I don't have any presentation for you guys. Our Kickstarter campaign ended tonight at 3 o'clock, and together with Oliver here in the first front line, we wrapped up at 4:30 at the studio, and I was in bed at 5. So yeah, I apologize. I don't have a proper presentation. However, what I have is I can give you an insight what our day-to-day business has been during the last 4 months or so. So we will have a look into the Kickstarter campaign itself, all the social media channels that we were serving and monitoring, and yeah, all the things that we tried to be successful as possible. So first question to the audience, who does not know about Everspace? All right, okay, three, four, five hands. As we have, this is the last talk, and we have about an hour, so I think we can have a short look into the trailer for the Kickstarter campaign so everybody gets an idea, and then we get into the details. So Everspace is a space shooter with roguelike elements. It's single player. We've done it with Unreal 4. And we have been doing space games for the last 10 years, so this is really, I would say, our core competence. A team that has been working together for 10 years on Galaxy Fire. And we try to bring that to the PC. Alright, so that's really a short snippet of Everspace. We have started with a project early this year, and prior to that we had a very similar project. We were working for a really big console publisher. There was also the reason why we worked on Unreal 4, and which is just, it was a coincidence, and we were very happy to work with that technology because it really is, it works like a breeze. So our guys can pull off things within days that would have taken us weeks or months with our own tech prior in our other studio. So the reason why we went to Kickstarter is after we got that deal with this console publisher, that was after pre-production, unfortunately it didn't go into full production. So we were really out in the open and we had to do something. And as we have been working on something very similar, we've been working on space game for the last 10 years, it was like kind of obvious that we do another space game. Still, we were thinking about going to Kickstarter about 3 years ago with a space game, but we were afraid that we get crushed by the big guys like Star Citizen, Elite Dangerous, and some others. And so back then, in particular, I hadn't had the confidence that we would succeed on Kickstarter. So sometimes if the pressure is on and you don't have any other options, you do things that you wouldn't do if you have other options. So I went to Quo Vadis in Berlin last year in April, and then people told me that Kickstarter is going to open their service for German studios as well. So prior to that, you had to have a US entity or you had to be based in UK to run a Kickstarter campaign. And they started in May this year that you can launch it pretty much in Germany, France, and some other countries. So we thought, okay, it's a little bit easier to set this up. And still, we had the situation that, okay, there are the big guys out there. We're coming with another space game. So how do we promote that? How do we position ourselves? I think this is the most important thing. If you go to Kickstarter with your project, you have to find something that is popular but not overcrowded, and you have to find your USP. How do you stand out from the rest? And if you're familiar with Star Citizen, Chris Roberts raised close to 90 million for his space MMO, so this is crazy. He started on Kickstarter as well in 2012, I think it was. He raised $2 million on Kickstarter and continued to raise more money on his website. So this was the juggernaut of Space Sims, and we're like, okay, we try to do this in a much, much, much smaller way. And as you have seen in the trailer, we're not about photorealism. It's very vibrant colors. It's almost a cartoony look that we have, and it's very action focused. So we're not a simulation, and it's also a single player game. Whereas our competitors like Elite Dangerous, Star Citizen, they're all multiplayer and they're huge titles. So we thought our chance is if we stay away from what they have, and find something that where we can shine. And serve a niche, and single players to a certain degree are a niche. Because most publishers say it has to be multiplayer for marketing reasons, and they just try to check their boxes to a certain degree, is also cover their back in case somebody goes back to them why a title is not successful. It doesn't have multiplayer, so they get screwed. And I was pitching that game at GDC. I was even pitching at E3, where we already decided to do a Kickstarter, and said, publishers, this is your last chance. If you want to have that title, we need to sign that within 2 weeks or so, because after that we go Kickstarter. As you can imagine, nobody signed that title, so we had to go Kickstarter. So how did we do that? And if you look on the web, a lot of people tell you that Greenlight together with Kickstarter works really well, and in effect it does. We weren't sure what's the right timing. Should we use Steam Greenlight, where you get a lot of traffic because you automatically, if you have something that's at least half decent, you get a lot of views on Steam, and you can try to convert those over to the Kickstarter campaign. So that was the advice we found on the internet. And we said, well, thing is, since we're a new studio, yes, we did Galaxy Fire, which had like 30 million installs, but there was a mobile title. Now we're addressing the PC market, so it'll be hard to reach out to the PC press and eventually console press, say, hey, the mobile guys are there, and we're going to make a PC title. So we didn't see any great chances. So our reasoning was, if you do Greenlight first, and we have a success on Greenlight, then we can go back to the press, say, hey, look, we got greenlit already, and now we do a Kickstarter campaign. Because we were told that the press is not super crazy about writing titles that go to Kickstarter, because obviously nobody knows if they're going to succeed, and the press wants to write about great stuff. So what we did is a little bit more than the trailer that you just saw. We took the best footage that we have. We put everything we could to make it shine, to work closely with Epic, show them what we got. And we got a nice quote from Epic supporting us, say, well, this looks really gorgeous and everything. And then we went on Steam. And as you can see here, we have a lot of discussions going on Steam. And very, very active community here, and we really answered all their questions. We got about over 1,000 comments on our Steam wall, and it really showed that we have something here, and you can see the game has been greenlit. And if we take a look into the statistics, oh, sorry, you saw that already. Okay, I just lost my statistics button. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thanks. I put everything up in the morning. Thanks for the advice. Logging in might help. So, long story short, the green light process worked really well for us. Shut up. Go on to the statistics. So we were on Steam Greenlight for a little bit more than 2 weeks. I still don't know how that works, when and on what metrics you get greenlit. But you can see we got 50,000 yes votes. We created 6,000 followers out of that. And we had a pretty nice, exception rate of 89%, that's an 89% of yes votes for that. And if you see that graph, so that was our competition in that in those 2 weeks. We had like 1,500 games applying for green light, and we made it to number two. I don't know who was number one, but no complaints here. And so there were two things that we took from these from this green light process. So the first one was we had really great news. So it's green lit, and it's not only just green lit. It's like 15,000 votes said yes, we want to have that title. So that's a substantial number. And we said, well, if you get 15,000 yes votes, if you get somewhere like a couple thousand backers out of that, then we might hit our funding goal, which was €225,000. But we got even more. Since we got so many comments, we got a lot of feedback, what the players wanted to have in the game. So usually it's like you start your Kickstarter campaign, you go out there, then you collect feedback from the community, and you adapt your stretch goals, your whole strategy, to the feedback of the community. Because obviously, if there's something super important missing in the game, you won't get funded. And for us, this green light process was very helpful to prioritize our stretch goals and what should be in there. So for instance, a Mac and a Linux version was, for us, was much more important than for some other games because we have a mobile background and we were really strong on iOS. A lot of iOS people have a Mac version. We also had a Mac version of Galaxy on Fire. So that's why we got a lot of requests. We want to have a Mac version and a Linux version. And although this is just for a small group supporting those guys are very vocal and they helped us. We believe they helped us spreading the word, and they were one of our earliest backers because they appreciated that we do a Mac and a Linux version, whereas the majority is neglecting this audience. So really focusing or at least supporting some of those neglected audiences can help and be successful here. All right, so the challenge is once you're greenlit, you lose your visibility. So when you got the green light, then you're not on the wall anymore and the traffic goes down. So the challenge is that you create something that makes all your Steam users go over to the Kickstarter campaign later. So this is something you have to find a way. And we did that with constantly having news updates on the wall, and that's visible, and then try to convert them over to the Kickstarter campaign. Speaking of campaigns, okay, logging in again. you saw the website that we had in the beginning. It was a very lean and a small website, and this website had only one objective, which was conversion. People who go to everspace-game.com to Kickstarter. It was not a website to tell you a lot about the game, because if you do have a website that has tons of screenshots, media, and so on, people are just browsing, and then they may not go over to the Kickstarter campaign. So the small website was just a landing page with a video, with a few screenshots, the team, that's it, and then detailed information is on a Kickstarter campaign. What we did on that Kickstarter, on this website, we used it prior to the Kickstarter campaign, and we collected email addresses. And these are pretty much our subscribers, as you can see here in MailChimp. Because if you handle a couple thousand or a couple 10,000 email addresses and you do a lot of newsletters, you easily get marked or blacklisted as a spammer, which is why we use MailChimp. You don't have to warm up the IP and so on. So MailChimp is a great tool. I can highly recommend that. And as you can see, we even had localized our newsletters into English, German, and even Russian. And if you do localize that, you see that even the Russians, which sometimes are hard to get as a German studio if you don't have localized content, we have a really nice open rate of 56% and 19% click rate. Industry average is in the low percentage range. So if the content is really good, if you localize, that helps a lot. We even have a diehard Galaxy on Fire fan from the very early days in Russia who does the translation for all the newsletters, but he also dubs our videos. So he does a voiceover for it, and he's super proud. We promote him everywhere. I love that guy. That's awesome. So spasiba. We can have a look in the. To give you an idea how that looks, why not? So this is, if you don't have a PowerPoint presentation, so this is really on the fly, everything. So you go there and you say, well, I want to have a new newsletter. Just give you an idea how that looks. So you use your campaign, and you can edit pretty much everything in a browser here, put up your screenshot, put a breaking news in there, a section, put in your links. So that was the last call. Okay, back now, otherwise it gets more expensive because we're gonna raise the price if you purchase the game later on our website. So really, MailChimp is something, I would say this is impossible to do this with Outlook. There's no way you can handle 10,000, almost 100,000 subscribers. All that emails are coming back, and the beauty is you also get that people unsubscribe, what happens, you see who are your strongest users, you can go back to them. So don't do that with Outlook. That's highly recommended. I think I would have killed myself already if I tried that with Outlook. No, I wouldn't. All right. So that was, it helped us to reach out before the Kickstarter campaign started. So we built some momentum with Greenlight. We collected email addresses through our website. So when the Kickstarter campaign started, we already had a couple thousand subscribers. And that was our initial core where we could make the jump. Furthermore, I can only say I completely underestimated the importance of Twitter. And I can say again, thanks to Oliver Berger here in the front row, who works at our facilities. He has a studio there, and he's a specialist in social media. He said, guys, you need to do Twitter. And I was like, really, serious? Twitter, who reads that? I don't. Maybe I'm too old. I don't know. And with Oliver's help, it's really things like that, like those GIFs here, and putting the right wording, putting out the right tags, identifying followers or Twitter people who have a lot of followers within your interest group. Reach out to those guys, reach out to them directly, make them follow you, write about your stuff, and if it's great stuff, you can tweet about your latest screenshots, videos, or whatsoever a couple times a day. It doesn't matter. It's not really you do it once and you're done. Because Twitter goes like, it's a constant feed. And people may miss that. And if we had more resources, I would have tweeted more. We just try to have like a couple tweets per day. And as you can see, we're handling different accounts. So we have an Everspace game account. We have a Rockfish Games account so that we can play with the news. So if this is something that's more game related or something that's more studio related, we could have different things and cross-reference to those, to our own streams, retweet, play around with hashtags and so on. So I highly recommend IndieDev, hashtag IndieDev. Those are some bots on there, so you automatically get more exposure if you put hashtag IndieDev in there. Of course, not every time, but this is very powerful. Then another one down below here, Dev Jam, and so on. It's really picking up conferences where you speak or something that's followed by other people. You put in your news there, combine that, and then you get your exposure. I know that also Oliver identified some of the high rollers in Twitter and did a direct message to them and told them all about a project. So again, this is something, it needs people. So even if you're a small studio, pick your channels where you can reach the most guys. It doesn't cost you anything other than your personal time, and reach out to those guys. All right, then pretty much all the links that we had, we put into Bitly. In retrospective, I would say, well, we did that, fine, cool. So I can check all that because links get shortened. Yeah, you're probably familiar. And you get an idea how many people actually follow your news and your tweets. So you can see with our main Kickstarter link, close to 8,000 people clicked on that link because of some activity we did on Twitter, Facebook, and so on. And obviously other people outside that outside our communication use that deep link as well. So it's like 50-50. So that address, Kickstarter projects, Rockfish Games, everspace.com, 50% of that traffic we generated ourselves through this through our communication, so that gives you a good feeling. And you see that the stuff that you do is effective. And as you can see, we put up a lot of Bitly links. We even put up Bitly links for certain articles. So if you found something really cool, like VR Focus, that has been a great partner covering us, because Everspace will have VR in their VR support, which is, by the way, we wanted to have it as a stretch goal. And that is something we learned from the green light during Steam green light, that there was a high demand for VR. And then we put it up as day one feature. And as you can see, we posted about that that interview. And then you see that people really follow that, and so on. So it helps you to keep on track. The only thing, Bitly is sometimes a bit slow, and the JavaScript kills stuff. OK, so now let's get to the Kickstarter campaign itself. This is the spotlight page. Once the Kickstarter campaign has ended, you can set up your banner that goes full page over here. You can still change that pretty much any time. And Kickstarter is not only a good place to raise money, but it's also very, very good to keep connected with your community and keep up the discussion. As you can see down below here, we got 657 comments. So that's still available. And also those updates, as you can see here, those are the updates that we have done over the time. It's like in Facebook, you see what's happening over the time, and you're going to keep interacting with the community and reach out to them. Okay, now let's have a look at the campaign itself. You see, this is a different starting picture. So that was our key visual here. And the last thing you do, that's something I recommend to put that in your calendar. You won't be able to change that picture once the Kickstarter campaign has ended. So make sure there is something that you say, well, thanks, whatever, come up with a message. And also the rest of the campaign, you cannot change that anymore once the campaign has ended, which is why we put a call to action banner in here that leads to our website where we continue collecting money through PayPal and other payment methods. All right. Let's talk about the campaign itself. So basically, it starts here, all the stuff up in here, the gaming press, we added that later on. But if you look at the campaign itself, it starts with those features. And obviously, you need to tell the people with a very, very short section what this game is all about. So we picked, it's seven bullet points, so there's no more than seven bullet points someone can remember. So we thought these are the most important things. It's a PC game. Sorry. It is single player and roguelike with AAA visuals and a captivating story. So that's pretty much, that was our core pitch. We put in single player higher up the list after we got some feedback from the community. A lot of people said, ah, it's single player. You should have told that earlier or much more prominent. Now I'm sold. Really, I don't want to have multiplayer. You get a lot of people say, well, how about co-op and so on? Then you explain it's too expensive. We don't do that. We had the feeling once we put up single player as part of our USP, we got a better conversion here. It's kind of odd because you expect that everybody says, oh, I want to have multiplayer, blah, blah, blah. But still, this is this underserved niche. If you hit the nail, you get a lot of support over there. VR support is something that we added. First person, a third person view that had to be in there as well. Then you show your muscles in terms of like we worked with Unreal Engine 4. It looks really great. You have your key screenshot. This very first screenshot, that is something that needs to explain what's in there in the game. We actually had, I don't know, close to 50 screenshots. And through various tests, we realized this screenshot worked the best. So because it's like first impression, that's what really counts. Things that we added later on are those quotes. I mean, this epic quote we had from the very beginning, but then this marvelous quote from Chris Roberts I will get back to that a little bit later. That's something that you put up on top. So really see this campaign up something that is, it's live. So you're not set, you don't keep it as it is. If great things happen, then you add those things to your campaign. Then obviously, the issue with Kickstarter with the video is it's fairly low resolution. If you have something that's really super cool and looks great, great visuals, you should implement those YouTube videos there, so to make sure that everybody sees the quality. I don't want to go to all the bits and pieces here. Those GIFs you might have seen on Contaco and elsewhere, although GIFs are really low-tech, limited colors, and so on, no sound, we had the impression those GIFs have been a very, very important marketing tool for us. Because if you scroll through a website and you don't push a button, this plays automatically once it's loaded, because those are pretty heavy, 20, 30, 40 megabytes or so. But once they're loaded, people see that and say, oh, okay, I get it. And we added a couple more further down the road. And so this whole campaign looks very lively. So it's really, you immediately see what this is all about. You have different scenes and so on. And that helps to get your attention. Okay, so we don't need to go through all the details of the campaign. Have a look yourself. On the right-hand side are the reward tiers, and that is something that's really important and took us a lot of time to come up with, we believe, a good set of reward tiers. As you can see, the lowest price for the game is 20 euros. It's probably a little bit too small for you guys to see. So 20 euros, that gets you the copy without anything else. And so we've been thinking, so what's a good price point here? So we were aiming for a mid-price range, 30 to 40 euros for the retail product later on. And we wanted to have a sort of a no-brainer price point in there. So people see that, maybe they haven't heard about us, maybe they haven't heard about the game. It's like if, excuse me. If you see the quality of the game, it's only 20 bucks or 20 euros, then we thought most people say, well, okay, I get it. And we had a big discussion if that should be a limited price tier, like an early bird, and then it's off. But then we thought, no, we rather have a good conversion and make sure that a lot of people are backing us and we reach our funding goal very soon. And later on, we try to upsell them, add more stuff once we're ready. Then we've seen from other campaigns that alpha and beta access works really well. So those were the next two tiers that we came up with. Like for 15 euros more, you get your beta access. And for 50 euros in total, you get your alpha access as well. Those three tiers had been the most successful ones, and the majority of the money came in through those three tiers. As you can see, we have way more tiers down here. And I have to say, the tiers in the mid-range and in the low 100, low three-digit tiers, they didn't work so well compared to others. My gut feeling is we were missing physical reward tiers, like a physical game copy, collector's edition, those kind of things. We thought about that, but we just had the feeling, we don't know how many we're going to sell. And if we just sell 10 or 50 copies and we have to come up with a physical box, we're just afraid that this is just too much work at that point. And so we're really focusing on the digital rewards. So while we had a gap, a valley of reward tiers in terms of popularity in the mid-range, something that worked really nice, I mean, you can't read it anyway, is... the highest price point is 7,000 euros. And usually that's this, you can come to the studio, you spend a weekend with us, you work on something super exclusive in the game, you get a mug, a t-shirt, a backpack, all that stuff. And sometimes you think, really, somebody paying 7,000 euros for that? And if you run a US campaign, it's even 10,000 bucks. And we put it in there like, oh, you can help a name create a main character in the game. Obviously, we just have two main characters. So this is something that's very exclusive. We never thought anybody's going to buy that. In the first week, the two main characters were sold. we were like, what? So our lady from the accountant, she's really harsh and always kicks our butt that we keep the papers and stuff correctly. And she's like, so how's this work? You sell a game that's not done yet and everybody gets an invoice? And we're like, yeah, everybody gets an invoice. Oh, I don't want to write those many invoices and such and say, ah, but maybe there are people that spend a little bit more. And she's like, how much? And then at that time, somebody purchased that 7,000 euros reward here. And we're like, hey, Susanne, have a look. Somebody just bought 7,000. And she's like, for what? The game? And we're like, yeah, a little bit more. It's like exclusive. I don't understand that. But you know what? There's 7,000. Get more of those. So, okay. And you know what? This is exactly what happened. So we were sold out with the 7,000 euros tier in the first week. And we're like, okay, we just had them in case we have to like push the campaign ourselves a bit or like to make it over the stretch goal, which is, yeah, it's a gray zone here. So you find people to do that because you're not allowed to do this yourself. Yeah, we were sold out. And then we had a guy, so one guy was from the US and one guy was from Germany, actually, very lovely guy. And so he's 60, he played Galaxy and Fire, all the space games. He's like, you know, I sold my company, I'm done. I just do what I'm really passionate about. And if you need any other help, let me know. We're like, okay, so what does that mean? So you know, maybe you need more money, like to continue again? We're like, yeah, we're looking like private investors and such. Long story short, he's willing us to lend us money to complete the funding for the whole game. So it's absurd. I mean, you find people you haven't met in your life and they give you such level of support, so that's amazing. So then another guy from the US said, well, I want to have a 7,000 reward here as well. So we came up with something and said, okay, well then we put in like space architect. You can design a faction, which is pretty powerful as well. We put up four of those factions. And then he came back, no, I want to have something nobody else can have. We're like, okay. Then we came up with something, so how about that? You get something that's an epic space relict. So there will be something, there's a great war going on, it's historic, and there will be something super important that happened, and there's a space relic that has an impact on all the players. How about that? I said, okay, I like that. But make sure it's just for me, it's exclusive. And we're like, okay, this guy is gonna pull back anyway, but okay, we put it up. We did that, put it up, he purchased it immediately. We marked it out at our reward wheel table, said, okay, that's sold. That guy pulled off three more times. So he killed his pledge because until the campaign has ended, you always can decrease your pledge, write it off or cancel it completely or pledge up. Well, of course, if you have the highest, you can't. So I was on a party, like on a summer festival or something, so everybody was, ah, how's it going, mid-campaign. And then this guy pulled out, I think it was 11 in the night, I was with a couple of beers, like, what, 7,000 less? Because you're on your phone all the time because you see the pledges coming in. This guy pulled off and we're like, oh, fuck. So that really is a big, a big dent in our curve. And that could lead to a negative spin through all the other pledges. So I was writing this guy, hey, did we do anything wrong to offend you, so what's going on, haha. And they said, ah, no worries, my credit card got stolen and I have a new one and I pledged again for 7,000 euros. So like for an hour or so, I was really like, oh my goodness. Yeah, campaign continued, everything went fine. Then all those guys who have HOTAS, does anybody know what HOTAS means? Just one, okay, thank you. I was, with the rest of it, I was HOTAS, hands on thrust and stick, which is like a joystick for space and flying as flight games. So I should have known better, but we're coming from mobile. So all those guys who spent like 300 euros or more on their joystick, they barely have games to play them or to use them. So obviously they're really keen on having those games and they're very vocal. I mean, very vocal. If there's a game that should support HOTAS, like a space game, and has it as a stretch goal. So that was kind of a, it's not a shitstorm, but it was like kind of close to it. So people were really, you have to have HOTAS and it doesn't make sense at all. And why do you have that as a stretch goal? And we hate you, and not everybody, but some of them. He was one of those. So all of a sudden he said, ah, so HOTAS is a stretch goal. Ah, I don't like that. And he pulled out again. We're like, oh, Jesus. Well, and then with like, okay, we're gonna have partial support there for gamepad, like in combat, you will be able to use your gamepad and eventually we will have support for HOTAS as well, but not the menu navigation because that's a lot of work and such. That's gonna come later. So we managed to get him on board again, but that stresses you out. That's unbelievable. So one of the challenges of a Kickstarter campaign is you get so many messages and demands, and there's always somebody who's unhappy. I'd say that the biggest challenge is to stick to your guns, make sure you that the focus of your game is still there, and you don't try to please everybody, because you will lose somebody else there. If we had said, well, okay, we prioritize those HOTAs, those joysticks, and then we have a hardcore mode later, then most likely all the PC players who haven't complained yet will hate us, who don't have a HOTAS and don't give a fuck about a joystick, right? I can recommend that. Don't get carried away by the feedback that you get. Make sure that you stick to your agenda here. What we did, though, is we did a survey 2 days before we hit our funding goal, because all the console players say, well, your console stretch goal, that's very far away. So we can have a look on the stretch goals to give you an idea. Yes, it's a very long campaign. There we are. So I don't know if you can read that. Long story short, this is where the console version starts. So we unlocked to 400,000, the third stretch goal. And this one down here is at 725,000 euros or $800,000. So a lot of console guys said, there's no way you're going to lock that, or very unlikely. We're not going to support you. And we had a big discussion internally if we should move that up, kick like additional content and languages further down, and have prioritized the HOTAS, the joystick controls. And once we have the joystick controls, yeah, there's one. See, and this is exactly like you. You're one out of 50. I want to have that. You're screaming on our wall. You're one of those. Okay. And we make the console guys happy. And then we have potentially a larger market to sell the game to. The thing is, you probably piss off everybody who's happy up here to get those guys, and then those guys decrease their pledge, and then the shitstorm starts. So as we didn't know really what to prioritize, what we should do, we did a poll. We used SurveyMonkey, and we came up with an alternative set of stretch goals with console and HOTAS higher up. And it was a 60-40 percent decision for keeping it as it is. Man, we got a lot of angry emails from all those HOTAS fans. You should support that. It doesn't make sense to have a space game without those HOTAS controls. Long story short, there's probably 1% of those guys who have a joystick here. They are very vocal. Yes, we will support it sooner or later, but we kept it here, and I think it was the right thing to do. And again, don't get carried away. If you change stretch goals, I think it makes sense to have a survey. Some people say we shouldn't have, unlocked or unveiled our stretch goals so early on. On the other hand, we said, well, those are the things that we have in mind to make the game per se more attractive and still collect money afterwards. As you cannot A-B test, you cannot run like stretch goal set A and then B, and you continue on those stretch goals who work better. It's really gut's feeling, right thing to do, easy to get distracted. All right, what else? Okay, what happened? KickTrack, one of your most important sites. I love that green bubble here. So in the beginning, that's kind of red, then it turns into yellow, you kind of close, and once you're funded, you get your green. So that's awesome. And everybody, excuse me. It feels like if you're talking for 4 months straight. So everybody sees that side, or everybody can have a look into your campaign. So everybody knows if you're doing good or not so good. And in particular, the view of your daily pledges. So the amount of money you collect per day, the amount of backers you have, and there are the comments. The comments are not so important. These are really the two things that matter the most. And okay, I try to focus on that now because we don't have too much time left. A typical campaign starts like you start your momentum, and then you go through that valley, and then you pick up at the end again, because you have a 40 hours notification from Kickstarter to all your backers. Campaign will end in 48 hours, and a lot of people are pledging up. And you have to manage to make this spike really high, and then in between make sure that the valley doesn't go too low. To get this first spike, you need to have your initial momentum for your marketing momentum, and we decided we're going to do this at Gamescom. Yet another thing that everybody said, you're crazy. You're launching a Kickstarter campaign at Gamescom where all the big titles have their news out. You're going to be buried. Nobody's going to see you. But we said, well, the thing is, if the journalists are going to be at Gamescom anywhere, if we just send them an email, probably nobody's going to look. But if they're at Gamescom anyway, and we can secure a meeting with them because we had been very successful on Greenlight and our game looks good, we can secure meetings with them. That was the Thursday on Gamescom. But we had more coverage on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, when everybody was back and they were done with writing about the big titles, they were writing about us. So it was too hard to cover the US press, but we were kind of successful for German, Polish, Czech, and UK press, also some French and Italian. So we got some exposure here. So while we had a nice bump up, so what we did is like, talk to the journalists, press release, then send out this through MailChimp, the newsletter through our couple thousand subscribers, Facebook. We will have a look in a few minutes if I still have time. And then we got that first spike. And then it went down. This one here, that was our first GIF album, or the first GIF we did. You saw on the Twitter wall, I had a couple minutes ago, those GIFs that go automatically. If you do this right, if you have a high quality GIF, you have to be very careful because they really hate marketing, self-marketing and so on. So you can have your own, how to say, subsection with an imager. That's where all those GIFs are saved. You can have it there. And if it's something really cool, somebody else will pick it up, promote that on Imager. And we made it to the front page of Imager that day. And to give you an idea how that looks. This is our imager site. So, and you see, I read out the numbers here. So 358,000 views of the album, but, so that was the first one that had 400,000 views. Seems a lot, right? In fact, okay, it's not this one. Okay, it's a bit tricky to do that online. Those are really heavy. Those are 40, 60 megabytes in size, which is why my machine has a hard time doing that. This, come on. Yeah, there we go. So this cloaking thing here, people laughed about, okay, you have a cloaking spaceship from inside. How do you read the panels and everything? We're like, we don't care. It just looks cool. There's no sound in space. Seriously, you must be fun at parties. We had that constantly. Anyways, this GIF, 8 million people saw that within 24 hours. And this is just amazing. If you have something, I mean, you don't have a budget as a small studio to show that to a lot of press people. You cannot have ads on Facebook and such. The only thing that you have is create something cool, hope that it's get picked up viral, and in our case, it was a huge success. And then on this, it's a bit tricky with this low resolution here. Yeah. I don't know if anybody is familiar with those upwards votes, like 10,000 points in Imager is really something. 10,000 people said, well, this is kind of cool. And if they do that early on, you make it to the front page of this Imager's site. And okay. Yeah, Anyways, it's a bit tricky with this low resolution here to show you all of this stuff. Long story short, when we had that day with these 8 million people, it was really like messages were coming in at a rate like ding, 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 ding. Does it have HOTAS? What are the minimum specs? How much is the copy? When is alpha? When is beta? What platforms are supported? We had 5 guys simultaneously answering those questions, like that, 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 that. And it's only 140 characters. It's like Twitter, but 5 times. And you get those, I don't know, like at every 10 seconds there came an answer or a question. And if you answer that right away, you could see like Kickstarter, bing, bing, bing. The pledges were like $20, $50, not the high ones, but those, the massive, that came through GIF and through this Imgur site. Okay, so a couple of minutes left. Hang on, I go back to the next spike. Where is it? Kick track. There. Okay, so again, this was first time GIF. Then Valley, 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 you start getting concerned, are we going to get funded? Because at that time we weren't funded yet. Then you have like, sometimes there's a high spender. You can see that here. So it's still the same amount of backers, but some medium spikes. So this is when you're kind of lucky, somebody spends 2,000 or 5,000. And then this happened here. Like, I can read the numbers to you. So this, the first one is 20,000 euros. This one is almost 50,000. That is almost 30,000. And this one is 16. What happened there? So we had our second album of GIFs there. That was even more successful than the first one. And going back to this year, I sent out a industry friend letter campaigns. Shortly after we were funded, that is, where is it here? This one here. So 2,200 industry friends from like my last 10 years on conferences and such, I sent to 2,200 people, only 900 opened. Well, open means like the images had been downloaded. 142 people clicked. Yes, but one of those were Chris Roberts. And we had been connected with Chris Roberts because we backed Star Citizen 3 years ago. And Christian, my partner, sent him a LinkedIn request, are going to be connected. And said, yeah, OK, pluck. He saw that, so he opened that up. And what Chris Roberts did is it's just fabulous. He wrote a note from a chairman on his forum, on his Star Citizen forum, where 1 million backers who spend on average, I think, $100 for Star Citizen. He wrote this nice coverage about Everspace. It's really just about us, nothing else. He said, note from the chairman of Everspace, nice image from us. He picked it himself or somebody, some of his guys, and really had this nice long article about us and said, well, this looks awesome, and this is great. And what makes us really proud in the end here, he says, the game is more action-focused than ours and should allow for some great fast-paced gameplay that will stand alongside Star Citizen, No Man's Sky, Elite, and all the others. I mean, couldn't get any better. Like, all the big space games are there. He mentions us. And he puts up a link to our website, he puts up a link to Kickstarter, and I'd say 50% of that spike in the middle you saw, that is because of that shout out from Chris Roberts. And so really, you don't know where the traffic comes from. This is unpredictable. The only thing that I can recommend is like, spread the word like crazy, do everything you can. It could be at a conference like this, somebody picks it up and then spreads the word and things go crazy. All right, then one more thing, an aimer. Anybody knows what an aimer is? Ask me anything, a few, okay. So on Reddit, it's a pretty small hardcore community, 10 million subscribers. And just text, as you can see. Ask me anything means like, we're here for as long as it takes, and we answer all your questions. And that is something that we did. We didn't even schedule it. We just said, hey, we're here. We let our community know in advance. We tweeted about it. We wrote out to our current backers, but also to our newsletter subscribers and said, hey, it's the four of us. It's our lead programmer, our game designer, our lead technical artist, and myself. And then throw questions at us, and then this is how it goes. So you have this thread, questions coming in, and we're sitting together there and synchronizing who's tackling which question. You do that. I think we did that for 4 hours straight. It's a lot of fun. It's great. You need to be prepared, obviously. So make sure that you don't, all the critical questions that might come up or had been coming up in the past, you have your right answers for that. Because even if you're done after 2 hours or 4 hours in that case, so see, it's quite a lot that we did. That stance, is available much longer than just a couple hours, obviously. And you can use that link and point out and say to your community, if somebody missed that, we did an AMR, then people recommend it again. So this is how things go viral. And things go viral if you have content that's really great to share. So that means that's not only images, but if you're very open, and if you show you're interacting with the community, you're answering the questions, and you may even change certain things if it really makes sense. That is something the community appreciates, and then they spread the word even more. Okay, so we covered pretty much everything. The last thing I like to have a look at is Facebook. It's not that Facebook drives a lot of traffic and a lot of revenue to you. Our gut's feeling is it is good to be there and have a high quality visibility, or the content that you have there looks nice. So we had 3 Facebook accounts that we monitored or managed. One was obviously about the game. So we made sure that all our video blogs mentioned here, the AMR and so on, obviously some important milestones. And so that is something we had for the Everspace account. Then we had a Rockfish account, and obviously, if such great news like Chris Roberts covering us is something you put up on your site, gets picked up by other people, and then they spread it. And there's advice. You probably have a lot of friends on Facebook, and pretty much everybody says, oh, I like that. That's kind of awesome. That's cool. That's nice. But it doesn't help you at all. The only thing that helps you is if somebody shares it. The thing is, only a few people do that. So I'd say, well, if a post has like 100 likes, we get 1 share or 2. The easiest thing is like, your good friends, hey, you like me, that's nice. It would be even better if you share it. No worries if that's too much to ask, but if you want to really help us, share it. I did that 20 times. 18 people shared it right after I wrote that message. So it's absolutely okay to ask those guys and say, well, if you want to help us, yeah, share the news, because this is really how our marketing goes and our digital marketing in that regard goes. And so we have a couple hundred followers on Facebook. And obviously my private account, I have a little bit more because I've been around a lot. And what really worked are those, I would say, private moments where you're like, wow, we hit our stretch goal, our campaign has ended, or those 10,000 backers, 400,000 euros in funding, a few more days to go. And that got 118 likes. It doesn't seem a lot, but it got three more shares, and then it spreads out. So I would say don't be afraid to spam your friends with the great news about a game, because actually if somebody feels spammed by your great news about the game, he's not a friend of yours anyway. Okay, I think that's, I could talk for hours. It's a very, very intense time. We started 4 months ago. If I do it again, I would start 6 months prior to that to prepare all stuff, but the best thing is, yeah, it worked, obviously. And you don't know until you know. I can only encourage you to do that. If you don't find a publisher, do green light, you get your first round of feedback. If that is good, you have a very good chance to succeed on Kickstarter. If you just stick to your guns, be humble, be as you are, reach out to your friends, to your development friends, they will share the news. And yeah, you're doing fine. Do we have enough time for questions?
Yes, we have.
Okay.
Thank you, Mike, for instance. Story. Please raise your hands who have questions.
So you were saying it was a lot of work. How many people did work on that campaign, and how much time did you personally spend on it?
I spent, I don't know, 14, 16 hours a day. At least that's how it feels. If you do a Kickstarter campaign, if you are responsible for it, you don't do anything else. Even it has an effect on your private life. You don't go to sport, you don't see friends and stuff. So that's for sure. Oliver helped us. Oliver joined us in June, I think, on the campaign, roughly. So yeah, June. So the first time we sat with Oliver together, I would say, that was in June. And it depends. The weekend before Gamescom, you were working on the Friday was until 5 o'clock in the morning. Saturday was at 4. Sunday he didn't sleep at all and went right to the train. So Oliver on the project, me full time. For you, like 50%, 30% of your time went into there. Then we had all our artists. We had 4 artists creating constantly content for it, because we send out a video update every week, and I'd say that's the minimum you need to do. The biggest challenge is to get the communication. You saw all the channels, 2 Twitter feeds, Facebook, Steam, your Kickstarter wall, your Kickstarter backers. You need to reach out to them. Obviously, you don't want to copy paste the text everywhere, so that's a lot of work. Then we had Gero, our sound and video director. He was like, I'd say the last few months, he didn't do anything else than just working for the Kickstarter campaign. And for us, it was perfect to have somebody in-house. All the videos, all the video logs you might have seen, we have done in-house. I would say everybody that you can afford needs to work on that campaign. And also our coding guys, they proc'd certain things that we have new scenes, certain things had been scripted that might be procedurally generated later on. And of course, you still want to keep some progression within the game. Then Christian, my partner, who dug into all the numbers, like do the research of competing campaigns, PayPal integration. So where we left some potential or some money on the table was like we had the PayPal integration too late. We should have done that earlier, but it's just, you know, you cannot do everything. It's just too much. And also the website as it is currently, have that up here, hopefully, do I? That was a lot of work. So Oliver worked with Uwe, our creative director, until yesterday night, 4-ish, for the new website, because obviously that has to go live when the campaign has ended. And you could have 10 people working on that. The larger the team, the harder it is to get the communication out there to synchronize that, because also for this Imgur, Facebook, Twitter, those many channels, then those direct messages, you get like thousands of direct messages within Kickstarter. People are asking questions that have been answered already, which is why you have an FAQ, but nobody reads that, or just a few people read that. We had 3 guys answering those questions. Christian asked everybody who decreased his pledge why he did that. So that was kind of cool. A lot of people apologized. Sorry, I'm just short of money. My credit card was stolen, or I had an accident. My car is dead. Then this guy came back 2 weeks later. Oh, I got a new car. It's cool. I got it cheaper than I got. Here's your $50. I'm still with you. You're like, what? Some people appreciate that you even follow up on this negative thing, like decreasing pledges or canceling completely. And I'd say 9 out of 10, they said it's nothing with your campaign. It's just private issues and so on. And I cannot prove who has the most effect on working on that. It's just, it feels like, okay, you could do so much more. And the rewarding thing about a Kickstarter campaign is actually the more you do, the better you are. I mean, we're super happy. 420,000 euros, that's, yeah, made and more, way more than we expected. Okay, one last word about the funding goal, maybe. Obviously, our initial funding goal, 225,000 euros, by far, is not enough to complete that game. It's an eternal green light for friends and family to chip in more money to complete the production. So they said, well, we could lend you the money, but we just don't know if there's great market chances for that title. And that's why we came up with the 225, because that's 250,000 in the US. We had been looking at other campaigns. We didn't feel comfortable about 500, half a million. And I think that was just the right decision. So it's obvious it's never going to be enough to complete the game, but you can continue raising money on your website and you're going to find partners, because obviously after we hit the funding goal, all the publishers that I met at E3, hey, Michael, your funding, your Kickstarter campaign is going well. And we're like, so how about we work together? Huh? We're like, okay, yeah, let's talk. I mean, this is part of it. And it buys you time to get your next deal. Or if you're really lucky, through continuous funding, you don't need a publisher at all. Sorry, long answer. I'm not really good at answering those things quick.
Just a short question regarding KickTrack. Do you know whether the linear progression they assume, whether it's linear or whether they take in mind that there's the valley in the middle of your campaign?
They don't have that in there. So
okay.
it's linear. Yeah,
so,
kind of linear. Yeah. So I think that first 2 days, it's the highest number we saw was 750,000 euros or so.
Yeah,
but it's, of course, it gets more accurate the further you go to the end of the campaign.
Yeah,
it's an indicator.
Okay, thanks.
Sure.
Does anyone else have questions?
What? Oh! Update. Bill Gates, I hate you.
No, we don't. Ah, but it's kind of cool. Every time Apple sees I'm running Windows 7 on their precious MacBook, it gives them the creep, but you know what? I think it's the best notebook you can buy to run Windows. So. And I hate OS X. It's just not for me.
Okay, yeah. Thank you. I think that's all. We don't have any more questions.
Okay.
Thank you, Michael.
Thanks, guys.